Well, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Tommy Kreitz, and I get to serve on staff as one of our campus pastors at the Elgin campus, and we are so glad that you are worshiping with us today. Happy Mother's Day. You know, I want to invite you really quick to just check in with us right now. You can do that right at the top of the screen. Hit the button that says check in, and that just lets us know that you're here. And this is for our Harvest family. This is for everyone who's visiting with us today, and it's especially for those of you who are here for the first time. We would love to know that you're here, and we would love to get connected with you. Well, listen, it's Mother's Day, and we are so thankful for the moms in our church. And in fact, I'm so thankful for a mom right now. I'm gonna call my mother right now. I'm gonna call her on FaceTime. You guys can join in. You can join in on our FaceTime call real fast. All right. Hey, Mom.
Hey, bud.
Hey, it's good to see you.
Yeah.
Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
How are you doing?
Well, I'm okay. This is a weird Mother's Day, not being to be with my family.
Yeah, quarantine is tough, and we miss you. We miss seeing you face to face, but praise the Lord for technology, right?
Absolutely.
We can still see each other face to face. I love it. Well, listen, I want to make sure that I give you something really fast. You know, Zion, he made you something. He made you a Mother's Day card. It says Happy Mother's Day on it. And he did his best to draw it. So he wanted to make sure that you got it, all right?
Aww.
So are you ready? I'm going to give it over to you right now.
Okay.
All right. Did you get it?
I did.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, you wanted to make sure that you had that.
Yeah.
Mom, can you share just really quickly, not an embarrassing story, please, but just your favorite story of you and I together.
Okay. Nothing like putting mom on the spot.
Yeah.
Well, I have a lot of good memories, Tommy, of being your mom, but one really sweet memory was when you were Zion's age. So you were around 5, and I was putting you to bed, and we were saying our prayers, singing our songs. And before I was going upstairs, you said, "Mom, would you marry me?" And I said, "Oh, buddy, that's so sweet, but I'm married to your dad."
Yeah.
And you said, "Well, if you weren't married to Daddy, would you marry me?" Anyway, I thought that was really sweet. And wow. I love being your mom.
Man, well, I love being your son, and I love that you're my mom. And I love you very much on this Mother's Day.
And I love you too.
All right, Mom. We'll see you later. Can we hug before we
go? Hug.
Just give a little hug.
Okay. Love you too.
Love you. Love you.
Okay.
Love you very much.
Bye.
All right, bye-bye. Oh, that was awesome. I love my mom. Well, I just want to wish a happy Mother's Day to all of our moms out there, and I am so excited to worship the Lord. So let's do that right now. Let's stand up wherever we are. In our living rooms, wherever we're at in the house, let's stand to our feet and let's worship the Lord together.
Hey, happy Mother's Day. Let's get ready to lift our voices together. We sing, "This is where worship starts. Here in the temple of my heart, remembering who you are and all you've done. This is your majesty, and all I have tasted and I've seen, remembering who you are once again. And I see the Lord forever glorified, exalted and lifted high, and all of your kingdom me cry. You are the Lord. This is eternity. This is eternity. Deep calling deep inside of me. I'm right where I'm meant to be. I'm here with you. And this is true. That this is your family. Your stretching is far. All of your kingdom, in Christ you are.
Have some fun. 2, 3, 4.
Born to the darkness I was, rejected and cut off from home. I couldn't see his love for me.
Here we go.
They say he's not who he seems. Don't get your hopes up for healing. My eyes fell away when I saw his face. My heart burst to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. My whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside. All of my days are filled with your praise. Yes, all of my days are filled with your praise. My heart burns to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. My whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. Jesus came.
Yep.
Oh. No one could ever take my soul away. My eyes were open and I saw his face. No one could ever take away my faith. My life was changed the day that Jesus came.
Chorus one more time, come on.
My heart burst to life. I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. And my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. Now I know whose I am forever. Truth, oh, I believe, 'cause I was blind, but now I see.
that the testimony of a believer? We were blind, but now we see. It makes me think of a song, Amazing Grace. Let's just sing through that first verse.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Stand alone, you're the God over all I know. Help us rest. Help us rest in who you are, God. Yeah. Lord God, we do stand in awe of who you are. God, we're so grateful for how you care for us. We're so grateful for your love toward us, Lord. Thank you, God, that no matter what we face today, no matter what tomorrow looks like, we know that you're in control of it all, that nothing just slips through your hands, oh God. But you are the King, you are the ruler who watches over his word to perform it. This is who you are, God. God, I pray that we would really believe it today, God, that the one that we're worshiping is the God who is over all things and in control over all things. You're over all that I know, and I can trust you. We can trust you. We can trust you. We receive that today, that truth, God, that you are trustworthy, that you are good, that you're working things out for our good. We love you so much, Jesus. We pray all these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus. Amen. Yes and amen.
Well, hey, Harvest, as we continue in worship, we know that the Lord loves a cheerful giver. I promise I'm not going to make us do the offering cheer right now, okay? But because of what the Lord has entrusted to us, we give back to him. And so if you're part of our Harvest family, we invite you to give now as an act of worship and thanksgiving to the Lord. And look, we know that financial struggle is happening right now, especially in this season. And so I want you to know this important truth. Is that God doesn't look at the amount. God looks at the heart of the one who is giving. And so let's give with hearts that are full of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving for all of the things that he has done for us and in our life and all of the blessings that he has given to us. Let's give with hearts that are full of praise and cheerfulness as we give back to him. You know, in this season, we're reminded that Harvest is not a church with small groups. It is a church of small groups. And I love it that we have nearly 70% of our church in a small group. You didn't hear that wrong. 70% of our church is in a small group. It's so amazing, isn't it? I mean, it's where true discipleship takes place. And so now that we're meeting online on various different platforms like Zoom and all of the other ones, it has been so fun to see the posts from these small groups on Instagram and Facebook as they're having small group together. And listen, I want you to know that we offer a wide variety of curriculums for your small group to be using. And if you want to, you're always welcome to use our message application guide, which is a great way to apply the weekend message to your life. And you can sign up for that today online at harvestbiblechapel.org/small groups. So I just encourage you, keep leaning into your small group community during this season. And maybe you're not a part of a small group right now. Well, listen, this is a great time for you to get connected to a small group. This is a perfect time for you to do that. And like I said, you could do that right now. You could do that today at harvestbiblechapel.org/small groups. Well, our elders posted a new update that is a recap of their past year, and it highlights all that God has done over this past year. You can find that at harvestbiblechapel.org/updatecenter. Well, as we said last week, we wanted to let you know because of the shelter in place order that has come from our governor, we had to make the difficult and extremely hard decision to cancel all of our June events. And so that means that Act Like Men Palooza for our men up at Camp Harvest is canceled, and so is High Five for our children. And maybe you're like us, we're disappointed and sad that we had to cancel those things. And listen, it was a very hard decision to come to that. But we are so looking forward to the time when we can be back together. We can be face to face. We can have events like High Five and Act Like Men Palooza. We are yearning for those days to come back and to come back soon. But in all things, we are trusting the Lord. We are looking to him. He is in complete control, and our trust is fully in the Lord. Well, I have a special guest with me today. This is my wife, Kelly, and she is the mother of our two children. And so, perfect opportunity on Mother's Day for you to be here with us. And would you just pray for the mothers in our church and the women in our church as well?
Yes.
Yeah.
Father, today we come before your throne of grace with gratitude for mothers. As we rejoice in the wonder of motherhood, we approach this celebration with tenderness and sensitivity. We rejoice with those moms who have received the gift of motherhood, and we are prayerful for those who have either longed for or not received that gift, or have received it and yet suffered the loss of a child that was once their richest blessing. Father, I ask that you comfort, encourage, and strengthen moms with infants and young children. Moms with children who have ongoing and compelling physical, emotional, or spiritual needs. Moms of children who are distant in geography or in heart. And women who still hope, waiting and longing for the cherished blessing of motherhood. Your word says, children are the heritage from the Lord. We praise you for the gift of motherhood and the joy of that motherhood brings. What we celebrate today and ask is that moms, imperfect as we are able to nurture and comfort, to love, to abandon, to hope and believe that the best, and to give sacrificially because we are made in your image, and you are first, and you first did those things for us perfectly. Meet each of us where we are, in our strength to serve you, but also in our weakness. And show us how to receive and embrace the freedom and abundant life that results in your offering to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving. Protect us from allowing distractions and discouragement, grief and disappointments to cause us to miss the joy and peace that readily provides in the midst of the greatest challenges we face as moms. Remind us daily that we lack nothing because we share in Christ's inheritance, and we are able because He is more than able. Our sufficiency is found in Him, as we acknowledge that He is sufficient for all that we face as mothers. Father, as women of your covenant, help us live abundant lives of humble gratitude, seeking your best in our lives as your children and for our children by seeking more of you. We pray these things in the matchless name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who was the very God who comforted Mary through the deepest trial as a mom. In Him we are made righteous, and in Him we are more than conquerors. Amen.
Amen.
Hello, Harvest friends. Paul and Rita Balash here. Paul Balash, Rita Balash. Hi, babe. And boy, we miss you guys. What a great season of our lives where we could come out quite often. And I got to get on the platform and lead worship with people that I love and respect and worship with many of you. Just really awesome. And I think of you often. And we love the new Vertical Worship Project. So many great songs and so many people that we love on that project. And Eddie asked maybe if we would share a song this morning, just in the midst of this pandemic crazy time that we're in right now, but this too shall pass. And one scripture that's meant a lot to me is Psalm 61. It says, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And I just, it's so like, you know, being overwhelmed. There's a lot of things we don't know what the future is gonna look like. Maybe your present situation is really challenging and difficult. And where do we go? Where do we go with those emotions and those feelings? We go to the rock, and Jesus is the rock. Jesus is the rock, His name. We call upon His name. Proverbs 18 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run to it and are saved. So we go to the rock. We go to our strong tower. We go to our refuge. Sing this together. As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glory.
name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name, Jesus, your name.
Pray this together right where you are. Jesus in your name.
Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify.
Moment. Come, fill our hearts, Lord. Jesus, in your name we pray, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you. And Lord, we glorify your name. We honor your name. We bless your name. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, hey, I want to welcome you to our online service, whether you're part of our church family or wherever you're joining us from. We want you to know that we're really glad that you're here. And I'm super excited to share God's word with you today. But before we dive in, can I just say something? I miss you. I really do. I miss seeing your faces looking back at me as I'm teaching. I miss hearing the sound of God's people singing to Jesus and lifting high the name of Jesus. I miss hearing your Bibles open and seeing what notes you take of the things that God is teaching you. But this is why I'm thankful that we're gathered today to hear from God. Because even in this less than ideal time, I believe in faith that He has something for you if you're willing to listen. So I want to invite you to open your Bible to Mark chapter 10. And if you're joining us on our website, on the right side of your screen, you can notice that there's a tab labeled Bible. Go ahead and click that. I would love for you to be able to follow along with me as we walk through this passage. But before we do that, let me just pray for us. Father, we are thankful to be here today. We're thankful for your presence that's among us. And we ask today that you would teach us. We are ready to listen, God. We want to hear from you. And we're so thankful for your word. Pray that you'll bless this time as we dive in together. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, here we are at the start of the next series inside of our series on the book of Mark called Just Jesus. So today we begin Just Jesus, Bold Servant. And it'll be pretty obvious why we picked that name, since today we're studying the theme verse that we've picked for the whole book. And it's one of the greatest verses actually in the whole Bible. But before we dive into chapter 10, let me just give you a little bit of context of where we're at. So in chapter 9, we were up in Capernaum by the Sea of Galilee. So if you look at this map, you can see that we're up north. And then in chapter 10, they start heading south, and it says that they go into the area of Judea as well as beyond the Jordan, which I think is referring to the area of Perea. So they're headed south, and then in this passage, we're going to be in Jericho and then ultimately head up to Jerusalem. This is where Jesus is heading into Jerusalem, and what's coming next is the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And I think this is the final major turn in the book before you can kind of see the end of the book in sight, because we're headed into Passion Week, starting with chapter 11. But here in this passage, there are three things that we can see leading up to the Passion Week. And the first one in this message, just Jesus, bold servant, the first thing I see happens in verse 32, and that is that we see his prediction. Verse 32, the first part says this: "And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid." They're going up to Jerusalem, even though it's south, they're going up because they're going to be walking up 3,500 feet in elevation from where they're at. And I know to us in the Midwest, that's not like super familiar to us, because we don't really walk up to places, we just walk over that way or over this way. But if you were from San Francisco, this would be significant, because there are certain neighborhoods in San Francisco where I would say, hey, could you run up to the house and get my sunglasses, I forgot? That would mean a lot different to someone from San Francisco. And so here they're about to go up 3,500 feet on this trip. And so that's why it says they're going up to Jerusalem. And notice what happens right after that. It says, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. See, there's a change here. There's a shift in this passage that Jesus is now in front instead of next to them, teaching them. That's a shift, because the rabbi would normally walk next to his disciples and say, hey, I'm going to teach you about this or that. But now he's in front. And that means Jesus is on a mission and he's leading the way. It's like he's saying it's go time. And you can feel the intensity rising also in the response of the disciples. What's their response? The disciples are amazed. Why? Because Jesus is up front now. And then the followers, the crowd of people who are also there, their response is that they're afraid. And I think probably some of them are afraid because they expect him to liberate Israel from the Roman oppression, because they were expecting him to be that kind of Messiah, the revolutionary Messiah. And so if that's the case, then they're headed up to Jerusalem to start a war. And or maybe they're afraid because they knew Jesus had already predicted his death twice, and then we're coming up to the third prediction of his death, and they love Jesus, and they believe in Jesus, and they've been listening to Jesus, and they're afraid that it's actually going to happen. He really is going to die as they head up to Jerusalem. Either way, you see that there's an intensity rising right here. And then we get to this prediction, and it's the most detailed of the three predictions in the book of Mark. Continuing in verse 32, it says this: "And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, see, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him and spit on him and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise." This is the only prediction that gives us the details of how it's the Jewish leaders that are going to condemn him to death, but then they have to hand him over to the Gentiles, which in this case is the Roman authorities. Because the Jewish leaders weren't allowed to execute someone with capital punishment, they had to hand him over to the Roman authorities. And then notice that phrase, "and after 3 days he will rise." Here's just like a little extra credit thing. That phrase to me, when I first read it, I think after 3 days would mean 4 days, just at first glance. But really, there's just a little bit of a language or a cultural hurdle here. It's essentially saying the exact same thing that Matthew and Luke say, which is on the third day. Because in the Bible, any part of the day counts as the day. So when Jesus dies on Friday, that actually counts as day one, then Saturday's day two, and then Sunday is day three. That's how it worked in that culture. And he's saying after 3 days, meaning after the start of the third day. At any point in the third day counts as after 3 days. And you're like, well, That's pretty different. Well, yes, it's a different culture. It's similar to if you're Korean or if you have a friend who's Korean, you know that they count birthdays off by one number from what we count birthdays, because when a baby is born in Korea, it's born at the age of one. And I personally love that because I love how that honors the fact that life begins before the day you're born. And it, even though it's not quite a full year, it's still honoring the fact that they've been alive since conception, and now they're born and they're given the age of one. And so for some of you, that's awesome. If you're one of those kids who's like, man, I'm 11 and a half. Well, good news, in Korea, you're 12, and then you can still fight for your half if that's what you want. So you're 12 and a half in Korea. And then for others of us, not super excited about that, because that 1 year could put you into the next decade and you're not quite ready for that. But either way, the difference is it's a cultural difference. So that's what's happening here. Again, that's just extra credit. But the first thing we see in just Jesus' bold servant is his prediction. The second thing we see is his example. Starting in verse 35, it says, "And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you.' And he said to them, 'What do you want me to do for you?' And they said to him, 'Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory.'" See, James and John are nicknamed by Jesus the Sons of Thunder. So I'm guessing these guys have some aggressive personalities, and that's probably why they're the ones speaking up here to ask this of Jesus. And if you study this passage in the book of Matthew actually tells us that it was James and John's mother who literally asked the question, but Mark is summarizing that to show that ultimately the request came from the brothers. And that's consistent with Mark's style, right? He's very concise, and when you ask someone to ask Jesus a question, but it's on your behalf, it's the same as if you're asking it. And notice Jesus doesn't answer the mom in either accounts, he answers James and John. And I think that the indirect way that they're going about this question probably reveals that in their heart of hearts, they knew it wasn't a great question to ask. So they're kind of like, hey, let's get mom to ask him. He can't be harsh to mom. Everybody loves mom, right? And then they ask for this thing that they'll sit on the right and left of him in his kingdom. And it says in his glory, in your glory. And that doesn't mean heaven. They're not talking about heaven. They're talking about earthly glory, as in your kingdom you're about to establish. Because again, they're expecting him to go up to Jerusalem and start his kingdom there in Jerusalem and overturn the Roman occupation. That's what they're expecting. And so they're saying, what's about to happen, we'd like to be on your right and on your left. Then verse 38, Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" These two disciples aren't learning what Jesus just said in chapter 9. You remember, we learned that the first must become the last. They're revealing their ignorance, really, with this question. And just like Peter, they don't either understand or don't want to accept Jesus' messianic role as the suffering Messiah. They want him to be the conquering Messiah, but he's not. He's the suffering Messiah, the suffering Son of Man. And here, to drink the cup refers to suffering. It's the exact same picture Jesus is going to use in the Garden of Gethsemane just a couple chapters later. And his baptism refers to how it's not just drinking the cup of suffering, it's actually a submersion. You're going to be completely surrounded by suffering, even to the point of death. That's what his baptism means, both those things referring to suffering. Then continuing in verse 39, they said to him, "We are able." Now, I can't get into their minds. I don't know exactly why they're saying that they're able, but if I put myself in their shoes, James and John's shoes, I think their answer was going to be yes to whatever it was that Jesus asked. Because again, remember, they're saying, "Can we have this?" And then Jesus says, "Well, are you able to do this?" And I would hardly even listen to what he's saying. And I would just say, "Yes, of course." Because if I say yes, then I get the seats in the kingdom that I was asking for. So maybe that's happening. Either way, they say that they're able, and Jesus takes this moment to teach them. Continuing in verse 39, "And Jesus said to them, 'The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared.'" Jesus responds saying, "Well, you're also going to suffer. you as well as my followers will suffer, but those seats that you've asked me for in the kingdom have been assigned by God the Father. And really, ultimately, it's not that important. The seats in the kingdom, we don't even know who those people are going to be because it's not what's significant. What's significant is as a follower of Jesus, they're going to suffer as well. Then verse 41 says this, and when the 10 heard it, so it's the other disciples, when they heard that this was happening, they began to be indignant at James and John. And when I first read that, I thought it was because they're correcting James and John. They're saying, you shouldn't have asked that question. But no, actually, when you study the word indignant, what's happening here is they're mad at James and John for beating them to the punch to ask for those seats in the kingdom. So then Jesus gathers them all, like a good teacher that he is, and this is what happens, verse 42. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. What's the lesson he's giving? Well, it starts with these two parallel statements of fact. And you use parallel statements to help people understand something you're saying with just greater clarity. And that's what Jesus is doing. So the first parallel statement is this idea of the rulers of the Gentiles. He's saying, disciples, you guys know how it is these days. The rulers of the Gentiles, referring to the Romans, they lord it over the people, which means they're abusing their power to hurt people, to afflict people. And then their great ones, the people who they look up to, these people, oh, such honor, such great people, they actually exercise dominion over them. Both those terms, to lord it over them or to exercise dominion, they are a negative sense of power and oppression. And then in this next set of parallel statements, Jesus is teaching about his kingdom. And what he says is that if you want to be great among his kingdom, you have to be a servant. And if you want to be first, you have to be a slave of all. And this couplet, these two lines, intensify as it progresses, meaning it's better to be first than it is to be great. And in the same way, it's a low position to be a servant, but it's an even lower position to be a slave. And it's an even lower position to be a slave of all. No distinction. All who need help, all who need service, I would be a slave of all. See, Jesus takes the whole org chart that we're used to. He takes the ladder of greatness and the ladder of success that we're so used to thinking about, and he takes that thing and he turns it completely upside down. This is radical. This is just super different than the way I think naturally. And it's the way, very different from the way the world is. In societies, there's tyrannical societies where their hierarchy is a hierarchy of power. So the more influence you have, the more political power you have, the higher up on that ladder you get to be. And that's why it's called tyranny, because it leads towards oppression. But then in free societies, there's a hierarchy of competence or of merit, meaning the better you get at something, the higher or more great you get to be. And most countries and companies, they all have a mixture of both those things. But here in the kingdom of God, there is a hierarchy of servanthood. This is a game changer. I had to read it over and over again. Can it really mean what he's saying? Is this the path to greatness in the kingdom of God? And I had to start asking myself some questions that kind of stung a little bit, because I start thinking, you know, is my influence in the church, is your influence in the church growing side by side with your service in the church? Or as you get more opportunity and you know, you have more influence and you get to lead groups or pour into different people, as you gain more influence, is your service decreasing? It should not be so, not in the kingdom of God. For whatever it is that's coming, whatever greater influence means greater service. In the kingdom of God, the higher the position, the greater the sacrifice. I mean, just ask any husband who's trying to lead his family well. If you go to Ephesians chapter 5, the calling on him is to lay down his life for his wife, to give it up. And you think, oh man, it must be awesome to be the head of a family, right? The head of a household. Well, with that high position comes a greater sacrifice. And in the kingdom of God, there's no such thing as a leader who isn't a servant. You know, we talk so much today about servant leadership and how important that is. Well, I would suggest that if you remove the servant part from a leader, then they're not significant in the kingdom of God. It's not how he views it. Everyone must be a servant. Everyone must be a slave of all. And you know, as I started thinking through examples of many examples I have in my life of people who serve, and they just serve so faithfully, I thought of one man that I wanted to honor today because he served our church in a way that I'm going to be telling my kids when they grow up this story. In my mind, it's one of the miracles that our church has gotten to see over the past 18 months. And that's Dave Stone. See, Dave, when he walks in the room, it is just so obvious that what he wants to do is serve. And he'll find anyone who's in the room and he'll ask them their name and he'll get to know them. And then he'll find ways that he could bless them, whether that's praying over them or encouraging them, because he's a servant. It's who he is. He comes to serve. And I can't believe our church gets to have him filling the pulpit, and he jumped in to help this hurting church when not a lot of other people were really excited about that idea. He was so popular on Twitter up until he started helping us. And then suddenly he's like a bad person. See, he was willing to sacrifice things to help a church that desperately needed help. And he served us. Dave, I just want to thank you. You've served us so well. You've served us in the pulpit. You've served us in green rooms, and you've served us in the lobby. And in my book, you're one of the great ones of the kingdom because of the way that you've served us. But I know that even your example is incredibly small compared to the example of the one that you worship. The example given to us in verse 45 of Jesus himself. He is the greatest in all history. He's not just the first, he's the firstborn of creation, the one who has preeminence. He is everything. And somehow, he gives us the example in verse 45 when he says, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve." How? And to give his life as a ransom for many. How can that be? Like, if there's anyone in the universe who is deserving of service, it's Jesus Christ himself. And yet he comes and he puts that aside. He didn't come to be served, but he came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The word many there is not so that you think about who's the many. No, it's bringing up the point that it's just a lot of people, that this one man, the Son of Man, would give his life and many, many people are going to be ransomed. The word ransom means to pay the price to purchase. And Jesus is giving his life as the payment to purchase the freedom of his people. And while James and John are talking about getting, Jesus is talking about giving and about giving his life. Man, is that consistent with the way you live your life? With how much you talk about yourself during the day? And in your mind, you have all these thoughts about yourself. Versus how much time we talk about serving others or ways that we could help other people. One of the first steps to getting a healthier thought life is to simply fill your mind with thoughts about others rather than yourself. Stop thinking about yourself just all day, what I want, what I think. And I'm blown away by Jesus' example here as our bold servant. So we see his prediction, we see his example, and then finally this. We're going to see his compassion. From verse 46 to the end, there's the healing of a blind man here. And this is going to show us a contrast between the spiritual insight of a blind man, contrasting that with the spiritual blindness of the disciples. And this is the last healing that Jesus is going to perform in the book of Mark. There's no more healings of people from here to the end of the book. And right at the beginning in verse 46, there are two things here in this first verse that might not make sense at first glance. And I want to take the time to address them just because I'm trying to be a good teacher to you. And these are the things I love studying in the Bible. But let me just say this. The Bible is not a puzzle to solve. Meaning, you're not supposed to like rip out the pages and put together some sort of like national treasure-esque kind of map that you're supposed to, oh, now I understand the Bible. That's not what the Bible is. But it is deep, and you need to take the time to dive into it. On the flip side, it's not like a YouTube video where you can just like watch this two-minute video and now you know how to change your oil, or it's not like a diet pill that if you just take that one pill every day, you can weigh whatever you want. It's so great and so easy. That's not the Bible. The Bible is a book. Think about that. It's a book. So, and it's not just a book, actually. It's made up of 66 books inside of it. So really, it's a library. It's a small library that's ready for you to dive into it and understand it with the help of the Holy Spirit. So instead of pulling back anytime you see something that doesn't make sense at first glance, I want to invite you to dive in. And here are two examples of what happens when you dive in. Verse 46 says this, "And they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside." So the first thing is, if we read this in Mark, it says Bartimaeus is sitting by the roadside. But if we go back to Matthew chapter 20, verse 30, it actually says that there are two blind men. And so you start looking at it and you're like, oh man, Matthew said two, Mark says one, something's wrong. Well, okay, again, let's spend a little bit more than 10 seconds looking at something like this in Scripture. It's actually not that hard to understand. Let me illustrate it this way. So check out this picture. Now let me ask you this question. Are there two shoes in this picture? The answer is yes. There are two shoes in this picture. But now let me ask you this. Is there a shoe in this picture? The answer is still yes. See, we're used to in English, like every time we say that there is something, that it means something exclusive, that there can't be anything else. But it's not false to say there's a shoe in this picture because there is. There's a shoe and there's also another shoe. And that's what's happening. Matthew's saying there's two people on the road and Mark is just saying one. But that actually makes a lot of sense because Mark is the only one who gives us the name of the blind person who is Bartimaeus. Think about it. We've been studying this book all year. When was the last time you saw a name pop up with a healing? It's always just like, and there was a blind person or there was someone who needed healing. We don't really get the names, and here Mark gives us the name, which I think what's happening is Bartimaeus is going to be known to the readers of this book of Mark that he's writing in the early church, and so I think he's giving us the conversion story of someone significant in the early church in the first century. So that's our way of understanding that. And there's two people in Matthew, there's one person in Mark, but no contradiction there. Then the second thing is that you notice it says that while they were leaving Jericho. But if we go to Luke's account in chapter 18, verse 35, it says, as he drew near to Jericho. Okay, so which one is it? Are they drawing near to Jericho or are they leaving? Okay, well, let's dive in. First, let's think about Jericho. Where have we heard that before? Well, you got to remember Joshua, right? So thousands of years before this story, we have Joshua, and Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. Jericho. See, pastor's kids like memorize all the kids' songs. It's part of the job. So he fights the battle of Jericho and the walls came a tumbling down. And so here we are thousands of years after that. And there's that city of Jericho, but it's now old Jericho because they've built a new city only a mile south of that city. And they call that one Jericho too. So there's this old Jericho and new Jericho and they're a mile apart. And so just for a second, The way to understand that is, well, if the healing happens in between those two Jerichos, then both accounts are accurate. Mark is saying they're leaving old Jericho, and Luke is saying they're getting close to new Jericho. That makes perfect sense. And you're like, oh, that's pretty different than our culture. And I'm like, no, actually, we have tons of things like that, even in our country. So let me appeal to you as someone who understands the Northwest suburbs. If that's you, if you live somewhere in the Northwest suburbs, you might know about this. Let's say we're headed up on I-90, you exit on Randall Road and you head north. So you're headed towards Crystal Lake. And I ask you this question, is the Costco before or after Miller Road? What's the answer? Well, it's kind of a trick question. The answer is yes, it's both. Why? Because there's a Miller Road in Carpentersville and there's a Miller Road in Lake in the Hills, and the Costco's in between those two things. Same name, I don't really understand how all these things happen, but that exists. And also, I researched that back in the Gold Rush, In the state of Oregon, there were, I think, like up to 8 towns that were called Fairview, Oregon. Why? Because it was just moving too fast. People were settling. And then the post office, it was just a disaster for them. People couldn't get letters because there were too many towns called Fairview, Oregon. And so similarly, that's what's happening here. It's the way towns are organically named, and we don't get to control that. And you're like, well, why didn't they call it Old Jericho and why don't they call it New Jericho? I don't know, but to anyone who was living that day, they would not be having this argument with you. It's just the way it is, and that's the way cultures are. So they're on this road, and Bartimaeus is a man who can't work, and his family can't take care of him. We know that because he's begging. That's what they would have to resort to doing, begging, because he doesn't have anyone who can help him. Then diving back in verse 47, and when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. To call Jesus the son of David was to affirm that Jesus was the Messiah. You remember we talked about a few weeks ago how this promise is given to David, and so we know it's going to come through the line of David. So this is a statement of faith by Bartimaeus. Up until this point, the only other person to acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah was Peter. And he says, have mercy on me, meaning, please relieve me of my pain. Help me, Jesus, son of David. That's what he's saying. And in verse 48, many rebuked him, and they're telling him to be silent, but he cried out all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. The people don't even view him as worthy of Jesus's time. And they're telling him to just be quiet. But Bartimaeus is persistent. And Mark always makes it a point to show how Jesus rewarded persistent faith. And maybe you're like me. You're kind of weary. You're tired because of all that's going on in the world. But I want to give you just a different perspective. What if instead of looking at what's happening as an outcome, we start looking at it as an opportunity? An opportunity for us to persist in our faith. For us to persist in our prayer, because God hasn't been caught off guard. It's not like he's like, oh gosh, I didn't want this to happen this year. I wanted it next year. Like, none of that happens. He's above everything. And so if he's not caught off guard, then we can view this as an opportunity to persist in our faith. That's what I see. And then in verse 49, something amazing happens. Here's verse 49. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up, he is calling you. So in the middle of Jesus headed up to Jerusalem, remember, he's in front of the crowd now. So you feel that intensity. He's leading the way. He's on a mission. And then he stops. Man, I'm just so not like Jesus in that way. Once I'm on a mission and I get in the zone and I'm focused, and it's pretty difficult to stop me at that point. But Jesus teaches me that I can be on mission for him and still have compassion for those around me. See, it seems we've made it an either or when it's a both and. You don't have to give up being on mission to show compassion to others. And all of us, we lean one way or the other. Some of us are like, we got things to do, we got plans to make, we got charts to make, all this stuff. We're very organized and we're on mission. And then others of us are like, but we love people and we want to care for them and have compassion. See, in the kingdom of God, you have both those things. You don't have to give up one or the other. You can be on mission for God and you can still take the time to show compassion. And that's what I want to be. I want to have both those things. And the people say, take heart, which just means it's fine. Okay, fine. Get up, go see him. Then verse 50 continues saying, and throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus, and Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? Remember that question earlier? It's the exact same question, but we're going to get a very different answer this time. What do you want me to do for you? And the blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Notice this beggar doesn't ask for money like he did everyone else who passed by. That's what he was doing. He asks for mercy, knowing that the one he's talking to is the one who can show mercy. And he calls Jesus not just rabbi, he actually uses the word rabboni, which is a heightened version of the word rabbi, which means Lord or master. What it is, it's a statement of faith. Verse 52, and Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Bartimaeus follows Jesus right after he's healed. What Mark is showing us here with those phrases is that he's healed physically and he's healed spiritually. And this once blind man will now be an eyewitness of the things that were about to happen this coming week in Jerusalem. And so Jesus continues up the road to Jerusalem, when the following week he will enter the city and he will give his life as a ransom for many, going there to die as our bold servant. So the call for us as his people is to serve. It's to be a slave of all, to humble ourselves and to choose it, to choose to serve. So my question for you is, how can you serve someone this week? Well, I'm going to give you some ideas, but they're just that. They're just ideas. It's just my list of some things you could do. I want you to pick something, whatever it is that you think you could do to serve someone. And I want us to all do this week. So here's some ideas. Maybe now that schools are online, there's a teacher in your house. And maybe it's time that if you're married to that teacher, you take a vacation day and you give that teacher a day off. And you become a substitute teacher for the day. I think that would really bless someone. Or maybe you need to record an encouraging video to someone who can't interact with any people right now. And if they just got a video from you talking to them, encouraging them, how much that would serve them. Or here's another idea. You could go to a restaurant, buy a gift card, and then drive through a neighborhood and pray and just ask God, who should I give this to? And if you don't sense anything specific, then just close your eyes and point at a house and just give it to them. The point isn't who receives it. The point is to serve. Or maybe you could drop off a care package for one of your small group members this week. Or at your job, you could take on an extra load or a project for a coworker just to bless them, something that you know you can do for them, and you just want to do it to serve them. Or maybe you could call an extended family member to just check in on them, someone who you don't talk to regularly, but you know it would really serve them if they could hear from you now. Those are all just ideas, but at the end of the day, here's what I want you to do. I want you to pick one. I want you to pick something to do. So do that right now. Just think of it in your mind. Out of all the ideas I shared or other things that are in your mind, pick one thing that you want to do this week to serve someone. All right, you got it? Now, second step, write it down. So if you're taking notes, just write it down right there in your notes. If you're not taking notes, pull out your phone, pull up a note, and write it down there. Just type it in. I want you to write it down. So you pick something to do. Now you're writing it down. And the last thing I want you to do before the end of today, I want you to tell someone what you're gonna do and when you're gonna do it. All these things are just ways we help each other out as a family, all right? So I want you to tell someone what you're gonna do and when you're going to do this thing to serve someone. I want this week to be an explosion of service across our church. And if we could track it, we would see it on a graph. Now, we're not gonna track it. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying if we could, we would just see time go on. And in this graph, we would see this spike happen this week because of what we're learning through the example of Jesus, because of what we're learning in the way of Jesus. Because in the kingdom of God, we're all servants. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the example of Jesus. What an amazing thing that he came to serve us. And we are the ones who have been ransomed. We thank you for your presence that's among us. We thank you for the way your Holy Spirit teaches us and instructs us through your word. So God, we head out into this week on mission for you. We want to serve other people because we are your people and we are citizens of your kingdom. Where the great ones are servants. And the first ones are slave to all people. So we ask that you would go with us, go before us and ahead of us, lead the way. And we just want you to get all the glory, God. Get all the glory for everything that happens this week. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Worshiping together on this wonderful Mother's Day, and wow, what a powerful message from Pastor Eddie. I don't know about you, but I am challenged and convicted, but also encouraged to go out and to serve. We have the perfect example in Jesus Christ, who is the bold servant. And so I'm hoping that you're challenged and convicted and encouraged by God's word this weekend to go out and to serve. What a great thing for us to do in this time. Well, listen, we want to care for you, and I want to encourage you to stay on for a couple more minutes. We've got pastors and staff that are available to pray for you. All you have to do is just type prayer in the chat, and one of them are going to reach out to you, and they can pray for you in private. Again, happy Mother's Day. You are loved.
Happy Mother's Day. We love you, Mommy, because you're the best quarantine teacher and you smell good. Thank you.
We love you, Majesticness,
so very much.
You're the best mom.
Proverbs 31:25 says she's clothed in strength and dignity and laughs without fearing the future.
Hey, Mom, the reason I love you is because you always try your best and you do your best.
I love my mom because she takes care of us.
I love my mom because she takes care of me and Luke and Hannah.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. We love you because you're funny.
You're loving.
And you always care.
I love my mom because she is the strongest person I have ever met in my life. Through all that we've been through, she constantly points me back to Christ in every situation in my life. I love you, Mom.
We love you, Mom, because you're the best mom in the world that we could ever have.
We love you, Mom, because when we need advice, we go to you.
We love you, Mom, because you love us no matter what.
We love you because you make good food.
I love you, Mom, because you're so sweet and selfless and kind.
I'm thankful that you make me mac and cheese, and I'm thankful that you make me hug and kisses.
I love my mommy because she plays with me, gives me hugs, and gives me kisses.
Hey, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. I love you, I appreciate you, and even if I said this every day, it would be enough, but thank you for everything that you do for all of us. You are very much the heart and soul of this family. So thank you, I love you very much, and happy Mother's Day.
I love my mom because she teaches me.
I love my mom because she always takes care of me.
Mama,
Dziękuję, że jesteś więcej niż matką. Dziękuję, że jesteś moim pomocnikiem, powiernikiem i przyjacielem. Dziękuję za to, że jesteś niesamowitym przykładem pobożności. Jestem błogosławiona, że mogę być Twoją córką. Happy Mother's Day!
Mom, I love you because you make dinner for me and hug me.
Mommy, I love you because you are a great teacher for e-learning and you love hugs and you like to snuggle up with me and you like to play with me and you are the best mom ever.
Hi, Mom. I love my mom because she plays with me and she loves me.
Hi, Mom. I love you because you're always willing to do something for us, even when you have something else that you want to do for yourself.
Hi, Mom. Thank you for working hard for the family and taking care of us.
We love Mom because she gives us hugs and makes great food.
Hi, Mom. I love you because you always play soccer with me. And I love you because you always make me breakfast sandwiches. Thank you.
I love my mom because of all the stuff she does behind the scenes. Helps us with our homework, makes us feel better when we're down, and makes us super when we're sick.
I love my mom because she cares for us, gives us hugs and kisses when we need it, and is encouraging to others.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Mom, I love you because you make me feel safe. I love you, Mom.
Mama, I love you because you give me band-aids and you hook me up with books.
So I love Mommy because she's loving and kind. She taught me how to ride a bike and she made me a unicorn cake.
Mom, I love you because you had to care me for 9 months and didn't go insane.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. We love you. You're the best because you always help us.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you. I miss you. I'll see you soon.
I love you, Mama. I love you. I love her.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. We love you.
Vera, say we love you.
Love you. Hi, Mom. I love you because you take care of me when I am sick.
I like you, Mom, because I make sure to be sound before I go to sleep.
I love that Mommy helps me with my homework.
Hey, Mom, I just wanted to say that I'm really grateful that you've always been there for me and always been looking out for me. I just want to say Happy Mother's Day and let you know that I love you more than all the other brothers do. So, yeah.
Hi, Mom. I love my Mommy because she made my food.
I love you, Mom, because on Sundays, you let us go on dates and have donuts at a park.
I love you, Mom, because you are such a nice and caring mom, and any other mom wouldn't be as good as you, and I love you.
I love you, Mom, because you let me have donut and a cereal and toast and bagel.
Mom, I love you because you're the best mom ever and you watch movies with us.
Hi, Mommy, I love you. Thank you for always being there for me when I need help. Happy Mother's Day.
I love my mom because she makes the food for me. And I love my mom and she snuggles me.
because we always play games together.
Hi, Mom. I love you because I love playing with you, and I like to go to places with you.
I like when Mommy helps me when I don't know how to do things. She helped me do it.
Okay. Hi, Mommy. I love to play with you and snuggle with you.
I love my mom because she takes care of me.
Hi, Mom. I love you because you help me with homework.
Happy Mother's Day!